First of all, I'm Karl Donfried, and my life has been relatively provincial. I grew up in New York City and did my graduate work in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and have taught at Smith College since 1968. And we have three children, one of whom is Mark, and that's my wife, Kathy, who's also very interested in cultural diplomacy. And I did my doctoral work in Germany, so that gave me a degree of expansive views. But why don't we begin right here? Just briefly tell me your name, not that I will necessarily remember, maybe I will remember it, and you know, where you're from and so forth.
I'm
Zena. Okay. Good, thank you, Zena. Please. Oh, we have someone else in the front row here. Nigeria, good. Good. I will be talking about a professor who's a friend of mine who originally came from Nigeria, Laman Sana, who's now at Yale, and I want to make some references to him. So it's good to have you here. Thank you.
My name is Christine Michael. I'm from Tanzania, and I did my bachelor's in international communication and applied psychology, and I'm here doing my master's in international communication and
psychology. Super. A lot of diverse backgrounds, yes. Oh, yeah. And what do you mean by the humanities, or what does the school mean by humanities? Where was that?
Where?
Oh, Texas. Right. Good. Either one of you. And what is meant by applied English?
Okay.
Good. Thank you. And your name was?
Marie.
I'm
from Egypt. I have a bachelor's degree in economics. I studied international economics and
cultural. Super. Yes. And what degree are you taking now?
PhD,
yes, good. Well, we certainly have a very diverse group, and I look forward to learning from you as well this morning. Because one of the things I wanted to begin with is that many, many years ago, actually toward the end of last century, Mark and I got talking about cultural diplomacy, as we did many times, when he was a student in Columbia. And I would say things have changed fairly radically and dramatically since we had those conversations. One of the things that I learned from Mark and that I still hold, one of the things I want to do today is to indicate to you the complexity of the field of cultural diplomacy at this particular moment in history. It's not a simple solution. So I want to indicate some of those and have some discussion about that. But one of the things that I learned from Mark was he argued that cultural diplomacy involved a number of things, maybe three. It involved dialogue. So let's say you had two opposing countries, and it would involve some team would go from one to the other. Hopefully they would both go back and forth, and you would talk a little bit. You would dialogue about what the differences are. Out of that dialogue would come trust. And out of that trust Mark would put it, first there was dialogue, then there was understanding, and then the final result of that was trust. Now that all works fairly well if you have a coherent culture. So if you have one country that believes X and another country that believes Y, you can have that kind of a dialogue. In some places in the world, that kind of dialogue can still take place. But what I want to suggest to you today is that the world and many countries have become far too complex to apply that formula. So the question is, if we don't want wars, if we don't want hard power, what are the alternatives of trying to understand one another and, in the midst of difference, develop a sense of understanding and trust? And that, I think, has become enormously complicated in the last 10 years and in your generation. Let me give you a couple examples of that. Maybe 12 years ago or so, I just decided for the heck of it one summer to run an experiment. And I asked various people, if I had to go and describe what America was like for people who really did not understand the United States, what key phrase would you use to describe the United States of America? And I personally thought I might get answers like freedom, democracy, things of that sort. But I got a very, very different answer. And I consistently got about five or six people who gave me the same answer. I thought, wow, that's strange. Then I happened to have lunch with the now retired director of the Center for European Affairs at Harvard University, Guido Goldman. And I said, you know, Guido, how would you describe what is at the heart of American culture right now that we could talk about in a class in cultural diplomacy? And I was surprised. Here, the eminent Harvard scholar used the same term as a number of other people of all walks of life, and it was the term greed. And that really threw me a little bit, because I did not think that the central characteristic of the United States of America was greed. And of course, I think in a sense they were right, because we have seen certain tendencies in the United States of America. I'm picking on certain countries and concepts today, simply for the sake of conversation. Not that one cannot go much further than that, but I want to limit that just so we have some sense of conversation. Then I thought about that answer in the very bizarre, strange presidential elections that we look like we're going to have in the United States of America between Donald Trump and apparently Hillary Clinton. Now, Trump often would go on TV and say, I made $7 billion, we got to get jobs back to America, and so forth and so on. And there, of course, that phenomena of greed came through whether he liked it or not. And if you saw yesterday's New York Times, and I may have gotten it a day late on the internet, might have been the day before, but within the last 2 days, we had this very interesting front page coverage in the New York Times, which indicated that Trump, in his casinos, had one concern, and that was greed. And he really robbed people of money in order that he made money. It was a whole corrupt phenomenon. And I said, well, I personally maybe suspected that. But here now we have the whole New York Times, America's most prestigious widespread paper, the front page, talking about the greed of our friend Donald Trump. But then, of course, the candidate, he's a Republican, and on the Democratic side, you have Hillary Clinton, whose organizations, as well as her husband, have also been accused of greed. I mean, if you get $250,000, $300,000 to give a lecture, I mean, that looks a little funny. Nobody gets that kind of money under normal circumstances in the United States. So I thought to myself, you know, perhaps those people were right some years ago, and now we have this very bizarre presidential election which who knows what it's, how it's going to turn out, what it, where it's going to go. But one of my foci today is going to be America, because I know that well. But I think America has changed dramatically, and I think that's going to make cultural diplomacy extremely difficult. So those are some of the thoughts that are going through my mind. I happen to think that cultural diplomacy is a key ingredient for a world that is totally mixed up. I have not in my lifetime ever lived through a period where you have more countries struggling and at war with one another than now. And you know that better than anybody else in terms of the kind of stuff, tragic stuff that's happening in Syria. So what I want to do is to suggest that many of the normal ways in which we would describe a partner, which we would dialogue with in cultural diplomacy, that that partner's basic values have changed. Why did they change? How did they change? Does that have something to do with the phenomena of globalization? Because one of the things that I will talk about here is you now have a number of critiques of globalization as another example of Western consumerism putting itself in a position where it wants to control the world. Whether that is true or not, you do have a phenomena in globalization that does involve economics, and clearly an economics that seems to be hurting more and more people to live a normal and decent life. Now, I basically want to talk about three scholars. As I mentioned, one was an African from Africa, Lamin Sane, S-A-N-N-E-H, and he has written a number of very interesting books. The one that I will be referring to is Whose Religion Is Christianity? The Gospel Beyond the West. Now, Lamin Sane grew up as a Muslim. He then, when he was still in Africa, converted to Christianity. And now he is the professor of history at Yale University. And I have a number of colleagues who are at Yale. I usually stop in there when I'm in the area. And it just happened the last 4 years, my one granddaughter was an undergraduate at Yale. And I got to know Lamin Sane during her first year. And every time I went to Yale, I would stop in Sana's office and talk to him. And I began reading his books. And he was a fascinating, absolutely fascinating person. So I want to talk about Lamin Sane. And any of his books are extremely provocative, worthwhile to read. The other person who has influenced me very much is Jose Casanova, who's at Georgetown University. And he is at the Berkeley Center for Religion, Peace, and World Affairs. The Berkeley, B-E-R-K-L-E-Y, Berkeley Center. You can go to your internet and simply put in either Jose Casanova or Berkeley. I noticed just recently the putting in Casanova gets you more information about the Berkeley School than if you put in the Berkeley School. But the point is, you can get a sense of who is involved with that. I mean, that, in a sense, is an institution that is heavily involved with dimensions of globalization, but also of cultural diplomacy. And I have stopped in, my wife has stopped in, we have some friends on that board, we've talked to them, and particularly Jose Casanova is one of those people who, not because he intends to, but has complicated the whole task of how you do cultural diplomacy, because he sees the world as dramatically changing at this moment in history. And as I said before, I'm not convinced the way many countries are reacting to the other. We had this tragic thing last night. Maybe it was a terrorist. Some of the people think it's a terrorist group, that's a person trained by terrorists. We had this man kill 50 Americans and wound a whole bunch more out in Orlando, California, in Orlando, Florida. Tragic thing. I mean, do we want to go that route? or do we want to have conversations with one another? But in order to have conversations with one another, we have to understand where the other is coming from, what are some of the trends that are happening in the world. So I don't have an easy solution for you. What I want to discuss with you are some of the trends which bother me, as I suspect they would bother some of you. Now, the third person I want to talk about is Charles Taylor, who wrote this, who's at McGill University in Canada. He wrote this very fat book, but very interesting book, The Secular Age. And he harps on this theme of what is secularism. So what is cultural diplomacy? What is globalization? What role do the religions play in all of this? And are religions changing? Now, I can't go into all of the world's religions today. I basically, because Sana does, will deal with some of the trends that we see in America. And perhaps maybe the change in the religious dimension is also shaping some of the foci in America. I don't know, but these are questions we need to ask. So I would say we're in a period where we have to ask a lot of questions to think about these things before we come with solutions. Now, Sana, in his book, which I highly recommend, I would say anything that he has written is very worthwhile. But I'm citing the book, Whose Religion Is Christianity? The Gospel Beyond the West. And he wrote this book in 2003, and he gives some statistics here. Now, I'm always suspicious of statistics that are given in 2003 when we're now living in 2016. And so when I saw him the last time, I said, Laman, are your figures still fairly accurate? And he said, yes, I've checked them with the World Bank, and for the most part, you can rely on those figures as being accurate. Now, he argued that in 2003, we had 16,500 conversions a day to Christianity in Africa. That's a lot of conversions. 16,500 a day in Africa. And they're the fastest growing dimension of Christianity right now are in the various African countries. Then he points out that at that same moment, 2003 projected accurately to the period we're living in, you have 4,300 people leaving the church on a regular basis in predominantly Europe. 4,300. And he puts the finger primarily on Germany as the country that is rapidly undergoing secularization, but others as well. Now, looked at in terms of the larger picture, we will have, if this trend continues, a tremendous African Christianity that we've ever seen before. Although one ought to be a little bit careful about before, because some of the great early church leaders, St. Augustine and so forth, were involved in African churches. I mean, when you think of Tunisia, for example, that's where a lot of these people were very active. But anyway, if you take these figures, the larger picture, the growth of Christianity in Africa will be about 120 million people within the next 10 years. 120 million. And he projects in 20 years, we will have about 600 million Christians in Africa. That will be the number to really watch. That in 15 years, he makes the projection, there will be 600 million Christians in Africa. So we have this Christianity is no longer centered in Lutheran Germany. It is no longer centered in the denominations of the United States, but he would argue it's moving toward Africa. Very interesting. What does one do with that in the whole understanding of globalization and cultural diplomacy? Now, his thesis is the following. This is Sana. Sana argues that there is an irreversible secularization at the same time as there is growth, secularization that has led to a post-Christian West. Sana is bold enough to say, we are now increasingly, I mean, it involves Europe and so forth, the United States, other Western countries, that we are now living in an irreversible tendency towards secularization of what he increasingly talks about as the post-Christian West. Or to put it another way, according to Sana, and I quote, the secular triumph of democratic liberalism represents the evolutionary process of a discredited religion. I'll say a lot more about that, but these are the two terms that he uses. That democratic liberalism represents a secular triumph over the evolutionary process of discredited religion. You have an awful lot of people, intentionally or not intentionally, who are discrediting all forms of religion. Now, let me just stop, pause here a minute. I think we ought to consider for a moment what we mean by the term religion. One of my professors at Harvard was the great philosopher, theologian, Paul Tillich. And we were at a faculty student get-together with Tillich, and a few of us were standing around talking with him. And this man came over to Professor Tillich at this reception and said, Professor Tillich, I just want to disagree with everything that you have written about and talking about because I'm not religious. So I don't really care what you're talking about. It's irrelevant. And I heard that and I said to myself, how would I respond to that if I were Tillich? And Tillich said to this man, he said, do you have an ultimate concern? Are you ultimately concerned about anything in your life? And discussion pursued a bit. And he said to the group that was gathered around him, whatever you are ultimately concerned about is your religion. Whatever has ultimate meaning in your life, be there a God involved, be there forms of worship involved, or be there not. Whatever you are most concerned about is your religion. So therefore, he spoke to the man, he said, let's stop this nonsense that you are not religious, because you are religious in some way. You have an ultimate concern about something, and that's driving you. And that's the way I think that Sana is using these terms between democratic liberalism and discredited religion. Now, another point that we probably should keep in mind, and I'll talk about this, I may talk about it if we have time, is that religion is dramatically on a downturn in the United States of America. But has it really disappeared? One could almost argue, almost, that the Republican Party has become a reaction to what is wrong with America, and there many in the Republican Party will say they no longer take religion seriously. And you have the Democratic Party really being the party of what is here referred to as discredited religion. So all the liberals, or many of the liberals, who are disenchanted with particularly Christianity and Judaism will be in the liberal camp. So you have two parties that are not right-wing and left-wing, but two parties who are arguing about the fundamental values which the nation ought to have. But more on that as I continue. Now, Sana continues in this way. He says, the West, viewed broadly as a cultural system of ethics, images, music, literature, as well as science and technology, has reduced the mystery of God to a cultural filibuster. His point is, God really doesn't matter. Sana continues, truth cannot be known with certainty. And one can be certain about that. I'm quoting from him. And about the related confident cultural relativism that postpones indefinitely the questions of finality. He says the problem with cultural relativism, this liberalism that I've been talking about, is that it postpones indefinitely the questions of finality. What is the reason I've been placed on this earth? What is my future? What are the futures of nations? These questions of finality. Some of you may know what the word Gnostic means. I don't want to take the time to explain it now, but he says, so a Gnostic religious faith continues to be widespread in the West in spite of the demands for the primacy of reason. In other words, a carelessness simply pervades. We live, but we don't really reflect on this with any degree of seriousness. Now, what Sana is driving at is a term that if you're not aware of it yet, you should become aware of. It's a term that is increasingly used in the literature. It's the imminent frame. Charles Taylor says that the problem with the world today is that we are living in an imminent frame. He sees the world situation now as a frame, and what we are doing is basically saying there is no role for religion at all. It kind of disappears, and thus he writes a book, The Secular Age, an age which sets itself against all religious traditions. Now, I'm not trying to set the term religion up as the golden term, the right term. I'm not saying that religions have not done a lot of wrong thing and so forth. The point is, we seem to have, in some of the key writers today, a major presentation of conflict between a democratic liberalism and these religious traditions, which I'm referring to very quickly. And Charles Taylor refers to this as the imminent frame. Our friend Sana talks about this secularism as a cultural filibuster. There's this argument, let's drive away religion and so forth. I'll give you some more examples of that. Now, to understand the argument of Sana accurately, he distinguishes between three forms of Christianity: Christendom, global Christianity, and world Christianity. And he argues that the period of Christendom, the first of these, as a dominant force in the world today, is rapidly moving to an end. Now, let me say, the terminology that Sana is using here has been used by others in different ways. And I personally think that Sana could be a little bit more clear in the way he uses these terms. The other alternative, which I actually prefer, is that if you take Christianity back 2,000 years, you have a pre-Constantinian Christianity, which is then taken over by a Constantinian form of Christianity. What happens here is that the pre-Constantinian, the first, let's say, 313 years up to the Edict of Milan, is a Christianity that is constantly struggling against the Roman Empire, which is trying to wipe it out. Then, in the period of what is known as Constantinian Christianity, which goes back to the Emperor Constantine, but it takes place in 313, the Edict of Milan. What you have is a Christianity that is now world dominating. That's what Sana means by Christendom. He just extends that period. And then you have the pre-constant period, the post-constant period in which we live now, in which this is all being dismantled. So that this Constantinian period, or what he calls the period of Christendom, where Christianity is such a dominant force, is quickly evaporating. Now, so basically what Sana is doing, I think he should really extend his metaphor to include four forms of Christianity. But what he tries to distinguish, this is the important thing, so you're not confused. Sana is trying to distinguish between global Christianity, which we're involved in very much right now, and world Christianity. And I think Casanova helps him out here. Global Christianity and world Christianity are not the same thing. And a lot of people are very concerned that global Christianity is simply part of the selfish economic movement that is working through the world. Let's return a moment to Sana and talk about his global period. You want to keep in mind that his global period is not his final period, which is world Christianity. The final period for him is world Christianity, which has content. The post-Christianity, the post-Constantinian period, which we now live in, I suppose is weak in the sense that it doesn't give us any contour of what Sana is trying to do, where Sana is trying to say there's a new globalism afoot. Let's take a look here. The global period in which we live, says Sana, allows a post-Constantinian period to flourish as well, and it gives momentum for a new global denominationalism to emerge. Before we can move to this too quickly, we need to ask, what do we mean by the new global period, or what do we mean by globalization? What he does here, thirdly, this is next to his last stage in globalization, I think he does a fairly decent job in defining globalization. He refers to the age of globalization as the age in which we will, whether we want to or not, we become consciously aware of globalization. We become consciously aware of globalization. So he says, what really marks our world, among other things, is we're aware of globalization. We're not quite sure what it is, but we're aware of it. And he says, we are aware of it in terms of global connectivity. And by global connectivity, Sana means everything that happens affects everything else in the globe. So that's one way he defines globalization. There is a global connectivity in which what happens affects everybody else in the globe. And he also talks about globalization in terms of global consciousness. The combination of connectivity and consciousness defines what we mean by globalization today. It's the immediate sense that we know everything that's happening in the world. As I spoke before, some of you persons arrived a little bit later, the nightclub phenomena yesterday in Orlando, Florida, where over 50 people were killed, which is the largest mass killing ever in the United States. Everybody in the world knows that. You see, there's this instant communication. Now, further, in terms of the topic under discussion, globalization and the future of Christianity, we should add that there is the recognition that today we are living within one single globe. And within the globe, there are many, many religious traditions claiming to be universal and global. In other words, we are living, and this is Casanova's term, we are living in a world of pluralistic universalism. We are living in a world of pluralistic universalism. Casanova says, what is radically new today is the awareness that we are all part of one single global humanity living in the time, in the same time and space. We are aware of our interconnectedness, and especially the condition of plurality. So there's a lot that is going on, where in the past people lived, for example, in terms of Germany, into their isolated Lutheranism. That no longer is the true today. Not only do you have all forms of Christianity, but you have other religions which are participating actively in Germany. And then you have a whole set of values and movements in Germany that says, who cares about religion? All it can do is cause more damage. Now, Sana, in his discussion of globalization, puts the matter very similarly. He says, the world is becoming one, not from the synthesis of all cultures into one, or from the discovery of a common genetic pool, but from the accelerating pressure to acknowledge and celebrate difference when that is no longer remote. This is the deep movement of the spirit in our time. We want to celebrate difference. And both Sana and Casanova, two very different people, are basically arguing the same thing. Now, before returning to Sana's fundamental thesis that an irreversible secularization and the emergence of a post-Christian West, so all three of the people I'm talking about will agree that we live in a period of irreversible secularization and we have the emergence of a post-Christian West. Now, just if you stop and think about that a moment, that radically changes the internal dynamic of a number of cultures. How do you have cultural diplomacy in times of rapid change? Let's talk a little bit more about globalization. A major criticism of globalization is that it is driven by the logic of Western capitalism. This is one of the big criticisms that you hear inside and outside the United States, that globalization is driven by the logic of Western capitalism that spreads a monocultural version of Western consumerist society around the world, which contains a fundamentally flawed model of the human person. That's a pretty serious accusation that's being made, and you hear it more and more in the United States. Let me repeat it again. That Western capitalism spreads a monocultural version of Western consumerist society around the world, which contains a fundamentally flawed model of the human person. Further concentrates power in the hands of the owners of the human person. Further, it concentrates power in the hands of the owners of capital, and that it reinforces postmodern confusion by reducing cultural symbols of belief, value, and meaning to matters of taste and preference. Now, many of the sociologists today are saying that is exactly, they're saying it in a critical way, how Western culture is shaping and how it is shaped by human beings who believe that all that matters in the world is what I agree to. There's nothing outside of me, and I can agree to it. Now, many, including Casanova, make critical reference to the ecological crisis, and they call for a need of the resacralization of nature and the earth. They return here to Eastern religions. And they say, sure, if we let all our smoke into the air, all of our carbon, and all the rest of the pollutants, we screw things up. But what is the alternative to that? There needs to be, says Casanova, a resacralization of nature and the earth. He suggests that, quote, all of humanity will need to draw on the religious resources of all non-Western traditions in order to develop a more reverential attitude toward animate nature. The Gaia principle, says the Catholic Casanova, should teach us that there is not such a thing as inanimate nature, but that the spirit of creation dwells everywhere. So what essentially concerns Casanova in the current stage of globalization is that, I'm using his language, is that the subjective conditions of reflexive universal human consciousness and the objective conditions of modern globalization based on the world capitalist system, the international political system, and the modern scientific and technological revolutions have become aligned. Let me read that again, and we'll take a little short break. I don't want to have questions yet because I have some things to say that relate here to this first part. But let me use the language. So Casanova is saying that the subjective conditions of reflexive universal human consciousness and the objective conditions of modern global civilization are becoming aligned. Put it in short, what he is arguing, Casanova is arguing, that globalization as an economically selfish force, big companies say, look, we can become even bigger, and we can earn more money. That selfishness is also becoming aligned with the emptiness of the human being, where all that matters is not any external structure, but only what matters to me. Well, why don't we see what time it is here? We have about a quarter after 11. Why don't we just take a 5-minute stretch and come back and I'll finish, and then we'll have some time for discussion. When Mark and I first began talking about cultural diplomacy, last century it really was, we could talk about it in a fairly straightforward way. I always liked the definition that Mark had, which was dialogue leads to trust, understanding, and that leads to trust. But I then pointed out that the America in which I live has changed very dramatically since we spoke about that. And I gave the example of having spoken to a whole bunch of people asking them recently, within the last decade or so, how would they describe what is at the heart of America? I normally would have described things like freedom, democracy, and so forth. And the overwhelming response was greed. And now, my point is you cannot really dialogue with another culture unless you have some sense of what, or the people who represent that culture have some sense of what they really represent. And I would say the problem right now we're having with the elections in America that are coming up is that we don't have a clear understanding of who America is. And you have two very different presentations by the presumed candidates, Trump and Hillary Clinton, as to what that is. But I just wanted to mention that was at the start. I wanted to say that the whole phenomena of globalization has gotten to be so complex that it also impacts the important work that cultural diplomacy still has to do. I'm not in any way discounting cultural diplomacy. I think it's key. But in order to make it relevant and to really address situations, one has to have a sense of what are the major issues. All right, let me continue then with Sana, and I want to return to his main thesis. He argues that secularization has led to a post-Christian West, but also to a post-Western Christianity. So he is arguing, we'll define secularization in a moment, but he argues that secularization has had some dramatic impact on the force of religion in Western countries. It has led to a post-Christian West and to a post-Christian, to a post-Western Christianity. Now, this post-Western Christianity should be referred to as world Christianity. So he says the situation that we are now in is world Christianity and not as global Christianity. It should not be called global Christianity, for we know that that has been overlaid with consumerism and has commodified religion. So in order to stay away from religion, in this case Christianity, of being so commodified and so involved with consumerism, he wants a totally new term for the Christianity that is now appearing, and he refers to the term world Christianity. And you'll hear in a moment why. Further, post-Christian global Christianity is impotent to counter the erosion of the social, the emotional social attachments as they themselves have become commodified and adjust to the secular world. What does he mean by that? He says that post-Christian global Christianity, that's why he prefers the new term world Christianity, has no power to counter the erosion of social attachments being eroded. And he says, one of the things we have to be very careful about in the world in which we live, and a lot of sociologists are saying this in America, I'm not sure how it is in the rest of the world. Well, Sana, in a sense, comes from another world, and he argues it too, that in this new globalization, we live our lives primarily individually. The whole phenomena of friendship, being with groups, is clearly on the downward trend. And one of the things he accuses is the iPad. Not the iPad, the iPhones. Just to mention one brand. That if you're constantly looking by yourself and in dialogue with yourself with that one weapon, you're not talking with other people. And he says basically emotional social attachments have gone way down. We're having less children. There's less understanding of marriage and so forth. He goes on a great deal about this. And he says, in this global Christianity, what global Christianity has done is it has followed the world, and it has become commodified and adjusted to that world. With Casanova, one could argue an even broader point that religion no longer lives in tension with the world. That's a big point that is also made by a number of other scholars. Religion no longer lives in tension with the world, but it follows the world. And for that reason, Sana believes there must be a distinction in terminology between the two terms that I have referred to. I thought someone was trying to get it and had locked off. Okay. With Casanova, one could argue then that religion no longer lives in tension with the world. It has accommodated itself to it, and therefore has lost its utopian, prophetic, or simply transcendent orientation. It has lost its utopian, prophetic, and simply transcendent orientation. I'm referring here to the, I went back to Sana. Oh no, I'm sorry, I went back to Casanova. Sana and Casanova, both are, one's an Italian, one's an African, both in America, and they both have very similar views. And perhaps it takes the outsider, in a sense, who has been born elsewhere, to come and to see these radical changes. Yes?
You have mentioned earlier that he actually had a statistic in his, one of his books that quoted around, in 10 years, there would be...
Right. Yep,
conversions in Africa to Christianity.
And then what?
To Christianity.
Yes, yes, yes.
So, but how, why would you think that?
Well, I mean, I don't know the African situation, but he is talking only about African Christianity, right? So he's talking about the dramatic growth of African Christianity and the radical decline of what he calls the post-Christian West. And you can tell, for example, some of his statistics are the following. Sana or any of us can count very clearly the decline of Christianity in this country, Germany, because if you're a Catholic or a Protestant, you leave the church, you pay church taxes. You have to withdraw from that office so the taxes are no longer paid. So you can see there's a sharp decline in Christianity in Germany. And that's what he means is the end of that middle period where things were dominated, different terms are used. Now, when he is talking about the rapid rise, he uses statistics over, say, about 30 years, where he goes back and shows the dramatic increase that is happening in Africa, and he then projects that it will continue for the next 10 years on that same path. Now, let me just, so he said that, for example, that in 1970, we had 120 million Christians in Africa. In 1998, we had 350 million. Those are facts. Now, what he projects is on that calculation, and he may be wrong, well, we're almost there. In 15 years, a projection, he projects 600 million Christians in Africa, which actually would have just happened. And I didn't talk to him about that, but I assume he might be out of his position. No, he wouldn't be out of position. Yeah, but it certainly would be known that the great Sana has made an error. So basically, part of that is fact, and part of that is projection, based on the tendencies that you have in Africa. Yes?
There was a certain context in which Africans converted into the Christianity due to imperialism and colonialism, and that's no longer the case. So
well,
could you give such a projection to my estimation? Christianity is still the world's leading religion, although it's the least in terms of how many believers actually practice.
Mm-hmm. Right, that's why I wanted to hold the questions to the end, because that's one of the sections I'm getting to. So if you could just hold that, because the questions you raise are terribly important, and I do want to take those. So I only have about a couple more pages, and let's go into that, and I think that'll be very a very provocative set of discussions we can have. Going back now to Casanova and Fasana. Well, let's take Sana for a moment. Sana argues that the term world Christianity represents both a worldwide Christian resurgence and that Christianity transcends ethnic, national, and cultural barriers. Important to note is that the world Christianity that he's talking about, as the movement takes its form and shape in societies that previously were not Christian, and I cite from Sana directly, a very provocative phrase, that any foreign culture is native to Christians and any motherland is foreign. That needs a little bit of reflection. We can talk about it later. He argues that any foreign culture is native to Christians, and any motherland is foreign. Christianity does not do well when the motherland is understood as being totally Christian. This comment leads us to a very brief discussion of my fifth point, which I only have one more after that, which is that deterritorialized religions and the new global denominationalism. What do we mean by that? Deterritorialized religions and the new global denominationalism. Shouldn't drink so much for 4 glasses. No. As market economies, governments, and cultures become increasingly interlinked and integrated across the globe, we have to recognize with Waters, who wrote this famous book in England on globalization, that such a development, the development that we're now seeing, undermines territoriality as an organizing principle for social and cultural life. And the same happens with religion. Territoriality as an organizing principle, that any one religion belongs to a given territory, is now quickly evaporating. Let me read to you what how Casanova describes this. What constitutes a truly novel aspect of the present cultural condition is precisely the fact that all world religions can be reconstituted for the first time truly as deterritorialized global imagined communities, detached from civilizational settings in which they have been traditionally embedded. So all world religions I can find in Northampton, Massachusetts, they are deterritorialized. And there are groups following a whole variety of religions, and it's not something that they've got to do in a territorialized context. But we'll talk about that in a little bit. Of course, what has greatly assisted this process is migration, the media, and the internet. It is this proliferation of deterritorialized, transnational, global, imagined communities encompassing the so-called old world religions, as well as many forms of hybrid globalized religions such as the Baha'is, the Moonies, the Hare Krishnas, the Afro-American religions, the Falun Gong, that we can refer to as the emerging global denominationalism. So a new phenomenon has entered into globalization, and Casanova, one of maybe the five leading sociologists in America, calls this emerging global denominationalism. Denominationalism is no longer an American term, but it is something that is throughout the world, and it is no longer territorialized. It is no longer the basic territory in which that religion first grew up. Of course, they compete with many forms of secular imagined communities, or ummahs, as well as with modern nationalisms. The emerging global denominationalism, in this respect, is simply a system of mutual recognition of groups, religious and secular, within society that is not regulated by the state. That's Casanova, his definition. I think I should repeat that again. The emerging global denominationalism, which he claims is new to the globalization that we see around us today, is simply a system of mutual recognition of groups, religious and secular, within society that is not regulated by the state. Now, finally, I want to get to this theme of what do we mean by secularism? What are the different definitions of secularism? And what do we mean by sacralization? But some of you came in late, so let me repeat this. I've already referred to Tillich. Tillich wrote an article about this, by the way, I just gave you the personal conversation that we had in a group, called Meeting Systems. And he says that meeting systems, not necessarily religion, meeting systems make a society tick. So the question is, yeah, we need to know what religion is going on, but we need to ask, what is the meaning system, whatever you want to call that, that is driving a particular country? And I would say in the United States, should these people like Guido Goldman be right, that it is this greed that is driving America? That doesn't come from any religion that I know. It's a meaning system, which has some, for some reason, come in with this phenomenon known as globalization. But anyway, enough of that. What is secularism? What do we mean by the term secularism? To begin with, one should draw a distinction between secularism as a statecraft document, a political phenomenon, and secularism as an ideology. Those are two very different things which I want to explain. Secularism is a statecraft document, a doctrine, and secularism as an ideology. What do I mean by statecraft doctrine? As a statecraft doctrine, it is concerned about the separation between religious and political authority. The separation between religious and political authority. Either for the sake of the neutrality of the state vis-a-vis each and all religions, and all secular meeting systems for that matter. This is well captured in the dual clause of the First Amendment of the United States Constitution, namely, the principle of separation. There shall be no establishment of religion. There shall be no establishment of religion. And the principle of no state regulation of religion in society means there is free exercise. And the question I think you have to ask yourself, if your country of concentration might be the United States of America, is whether that statecraft doctrine still holds today. Because many would argue that the free exercise of religion is no longer tolerated in the United States. And others would argue that there shall be no establishment of religion has become weakened. Here we are very clearly given the conditions for the possibility of religious pluralism in society, and one could argue that it is impossible to have a democracy without the religion, the freedom of religion. That was, of course, what the founding fathers had in mind. It was impossible to have a democracy without freedom of religion. Again, the current elections that will be coming in America, a lot of people don't believe, and I'm not taking any sides here, but you can read the papers. A lot of people don't believe that Mr. Trump has an understanding of what it means to have freedom of religion. He wants to control everything. Secularism becomes an ideology. So that's the statecraft doctrine of secularism. Secularism becomes an ideology the moment it entails a theory of what religion is or does. And many are criticizing the Supreme Court in the United States, other agencies, of secularism because it is demanding its view of what religion should or should not do. But anyway, let's go to this whole second theme of ideology. Basically, there are two types of secularist ideologies. There is the theory of religion grounded in a consciousness of emancipation from the irrationality of belief. Some people say secularism is, and this is Taylor, is the consciousness, you are conscious, that that you've been free from the irrationality of the belief that maybe you grew up with. That philosophies of religion relegate religion to a superseded state. So we are now at a stage that almost puts religions, for the most part, out of commission in terms of being serious molders of any given society. And secondly, there are secularist political theories that presuppose that religion is either an irrational force or a non-rational form of discourse that should be banished from the democratic public sphere. Let me just say that again. You have some secular political theories that presuppose that religion is either an irrational force or a non-rational form of discourse that should be banished from the democratic public sphere. Therefore, religion should be contained within its own differentiated religious sphere and should simultaneously maintain a secular public democratic sphere free from religion. So you have some people within the secularism that religion is no good at all. We should have specific secular spheres or religious spheres in our society in which all kinds of ideologies can be spread. Let me read to you again the sentence here from Casanova. Therefore, religion should be contained within its own differentiated religious sphere and should simultaneously maintain a secular, public, democratic sphere free from religion. So religion cannot intermingle as it did in the old days of the American Constitution, but these people argue it should have a separate, there should be a separate religious sphere in which these people can argue. In Europe, one has actually a more dangerous situation developing, at least as I see it. In Europe especially, one should add that there is at present a strong view that religion is intolerant and it creates conflict. One hears that particularly, at least the literature that I see from Europe, that religion is intolerant and it creates conflict. It is in fact the source of violent conflict. Is this perhaps too extreme? Since none of the horrible massacres of the 20th century, including the Nazi Holocaust in this country, were caused by religious fanaticism and intolerance. All of them were products of modern secular ideologies. Again, as far as I'm concerned, the wisdom of Tillich. How we define religion is terribly important. And religion can influence society in a variety of ways. And it doesn't even look like religion. It's what one ultimately believes is right and wrong. Casanova also argues, I'm almost finished, is that we should not overlook that modern secularization in the West also entails a certain profanation of religion. Secularization puts down religion. How? Through its privatization and individualization on the one hand, and on the other hand, there are sacralizations of selected secular spheres. In fact, many would argue that the truly modern sacralization, however you want to pronounce it, which constitutes the global civil religion of the West, is the cult of the individual, and the sacralization of humanity through the globalization of human rights. So it's interesting that the sociologist Casanova talks about, really, religions following what are the secular ideologies which are all around us. Privatization and individualism, as opposed to Muslims, Christians, Jews, whatever, participating in larger social groups, and what he calls the global civilization of the West, the cult of the individual, and the sacralization of humanity. That is what is sacred today. Some form of humanity through the globalization of human rights. And Casanova, that's another whole subject, but a number of sociologists are very critical of the way the human rights platforms have been shaped with their ambiguity. Obviously, there's a lot of good, tremendous amount of good in these things, but he also says they are possibly being misused in serious ways. I'll come to an end. So given this contemporary environment, that's all I've been trying to do, and you're free to reinterpret any of this. I'm trying to understand myself. What does the contemporary environment, which is changing so radically and so rapidly, what does this mean for the future of Christianity as one religion? Whatever your project is, you can do the same thing with another group, another religion. What is the future, I ask myself, what is the future of Christianity, especially Christianity in the United States? I would have to tentatively at this point say the answer is pretty bleak, at least for Protestant denominationalism. It does not seem to be going anywhere but down. You do have a right-wing reaction to this. Also, you find that in the Republican Party. There's a right-wing reaction to that, and one does not yet know where Catholicism is going. I mean, they've gotten a real shot in the arm through Pope Francis, who's enormously well-liked in the United States. But let me stop there and say that really has been my question. What is the meaning of globalization? How does that impact our doing cultural diplomacy in this age? So I have no ready answers to these questions. And I may have been wrong at some points in my presentation. So let's pick up either the discussion where I said we would take it up in 5 minutes or a few minutes later, and where we are now. What time, by the way, do you have to leave here? 10 of what? No, what time do you have to leave? Oh, one. Okay, so we have some time. I believe I cut you off in the back. That's right. You're absolutely right that religion also has to be understood in terms of the social matrix that it is involved in, the way nations go. I mean, we can see that already in the Protestant denominations, which are all going down, and the way the shape of the United States is changing. I mean, if one would argue, and I think one could argue, that for a long time, I was in New York City for a long period of time, and I remember when I was a kid in New York City, it was always believed that the civil religion in the United States was Christian, Protestant, and Jew, or Jew, Christian, and Protestant, however you want to put it. And that is now totally demolished as the structure of the United States changes. So I think those factors are terribly important in understanding what either projects a religion and what could inhibit it. There are a number of interesting books that have just come out. One is by a British scholar, Paul Winter, and I think it is The Future of Christianity. I find him an awfully difficult read, but what he tries to do, and a number of books now are precisely making the point that you're making, we have to understand once religions, in a sense, become deterritorialized from their resident place of habitation, what does that mean? But you wanted to respond, I think, to that.
Well, I wanted to say, like, early Christianity in Africa was based on imperialism, yes, but it was forced upon us. And now, I think Christianity is definitely on the rise in Africa because it's a choice that millions of Africans are making daily because of their own desires to follow God. I mean, God wasn't introduced to us by the West. We already had a God before we got colonized. And so our belief in our God makes
Thank you. I think one of the things in our area, we have a African video filmmaker, and he goes over quite a bit, and he makes all kinds of videos. He got a master's from the school I taught at at Smith College, and he has shown a number of his videos to various churches, Episcopal churches, student groups, and he has given me a few to look at. And I must say, and I've never been to Africa, unfortunately, it's a real pity. But the power that I see in African Christianity, by many, and when you see their worship services and their Bible studies and so forth, on all sides. I also have a sense that Catholic Church is fairly strong. That's my sense from these videos. I'm just impressed with what I see there. It's very different than German Christianity. And I have no bias, I mean, public bias that I'm aware of toward either one. Yeah, other questions in terms of what I've said in terms of really what I'm interested in and why I was so frank in this presentation, maybe a bit too detailed, is I am not sure what the next step for cultural diplomacy can be or should be. And it was, as I was saying, you know, last at the end of last century, when Mark was in college, and he and I used to talk about these things, this phrase that he had about dialogue, meaning, and trust. You know, if you had a communist party here, a communist state, and you had an American democratic state, but if both of those are now changing, how does dialogue continue? What happens? And I'm thinking of global diplomacy as problem solving. So some of the enormous problems we have in the world today, what do we do? But also, I invite any questions you have about anything that I have said, not that I can answer it necessarily, but let's at least air the question. You have a smile on your face, like you're anxious to raise a question, aren't you?
No, I was just like thinking about how it's very theoretical where we go, or how each country or each different opinion would ultimately discuss or solve any disagreement. Without hard power, because and as you have mentioned, the U.S. is a lot of people think of it as greed, and it was based on greed. Like how the history of the U.S. it was actually created and based on greed. So I don't see how this could be actually different in the future, whether let it be how complex or simple each country is on its own. If you have this notion, and if you are built on this notion, it's very different to create a different source of understanding or agreement with other countries.
So almost what you're saying is that we need to have a form of cultural diplomacy that is radically critical of a given society, or at least that can raise questions without bias. I mean, for example, when I look at the elections in the United States, there is so much bias on each side, whoever the candidates happen to be. Does one not need a group or persons who are recognized of some stature who are going to raise honestly questions about where X, Y, and Z will lead if one keeps pursuing it as one question. The other point, so that would be one question. The other question would be if we can get society, I don't want to talk too much, so let's say one or two more things. Let's say we had two nations that were very confrontational. Is it possible for each side to get a handle of what they truly are, what they are truly perceived at as, and to get those two people to talk together. I mean, I'm not so sure, I don't know, maybe I'm making a wrong assumption. I'm not so sure that we would want to go back to hard power, because the danger with hard power now is that nuclear weapons are proliferated all over the place, and we could really wipe out.
Yeah, but my point is that hard power doesn't exist, really exist, and has existed before. So,
What? So?
I'm thinking of possibly that the only way to find a diplomatic solution is to create a more powerful clique, or an equal power. The only way the U.S., for example, or any high power that enforces its hard power on others to be willing to give in or to actually create a really diplomatic solution mm-hmm. is to be confronted with an equal power and threatened by its power. Mm-hmm. And up to today, there is no way or equal solution to find an equilibrium with this situation. Mm-hmm.
Good. Let's talk about a number of these points that are being raised among yourselves. Yes. Other thoughts about this or any other subjects that were raised or tangential subjects that came to your mind as we were discussing or I was talking?
Sorry, you mentioned that the U.S. is not based on the moon.
That what?
The U.S. is not based on the moon.
Yeah, in other words, what the sociologists are telling us increasingly is that the understanding of a civil religion, be it Protestant, Catholic, and Jew, or simply for a long time in the earlier days, Protestant denominationalism, that seems to be weakening, and that according to attendance figures, influence, for example, I was reading Casanova, one of his articles the other day, and he says that the educational institutions in America, to a large extent, were religious institutions. For example, Harvard, Yale, Smith College. One could go through the whole United States and select some of the leading Ivy League schools were religious schools. They are not religious schools anymore. So, for example, the school I taught at, which is the oldest women's and largest women's college in the United States, Smith College, the woman who gave the money, Sophia Smith, gave money so that it would be a women's college, number one, and it would be guided by the evangelical spirit of Christianity. We had a large chapel with three chaplains. We have a large chapel, which is now a building, used for a variety of purposes. We have zero chaplains at the moment, and one can say as much about a number of other places. I think that's the kind of thing that is meant, not that religion has totally disappeared, but it no longer seems to be a very formative element. You certainly have reactions that are loud and clear, but not necessarily a force that politicians, for example, will necessarily reckon with. It's not to say it's totally gone, but it's clearly in a diminishing situation. Sure, but the question is, when was Reagan presidency?
Right.
And how rapidly are things changing now?
But we also see the rise of like Zionist and lobby groups shaping U.S. foreign policy in the Middle East today.
Yep.
So I don't think it's fair to say that religion does not play a role in shaping the U.S., both internally and externally, and it's foreign policy and internal policy as well. And we see that, I mean, with the Chapel Hill shooting,
right, but
we have these huge screams from people, from society itself, saying, yeah, religion is still playing a big role. There's a me and them, and there's a us and other. And I think for Casanova, who's, you know, really in the academic field, they have to say something like this is almost delusional, in my opinion.
To say, well, the question would be the matter of reading books and the actual participation. I would just have two comments, and I'm not saying my comments are necessarily correct, but many of the foreign policy issues that you have spoken to are really more policy decisions made by a host of interested people in a given issue. For example, I haven't seen major Jewish leaders or groups in the United States necessarily come out and make policy decisions or recommend a policy decision.
That's what's that?
Yeah,
that's not how they're going to do things. Like, no one's ever done anything like that. No one ever will. That's why there's a lobby group, and that's why things happen in the meantime. And then you get official statements with people like the president or official spokesmen saying these things. It's like not using the word terrorist to describe the Chapel Hill shooting,
yeah,
and then using it yesterday automatically. It's stuff like that. It's these small things in society that nobody notices, but it's ingrained in people's minds through the media, through the official spokesperson, because obviously the president is the person of power, so whatever he says is correct.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the language he uses that does shape everyone else's opinion.
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, I'm not trying to defend Casanova, but number one, it's all based on religion, hinges on how one understands religion. And I think what Casanova, in fairness to Casanova, is trying to do is to say the sudden shaping and reshaping that is happening within the last 4 to 5 years. I mean, that's how immediate. That is. I was talking to Casanova 2 years ago. He actually comes from out of a Catholic background. And he said, everything, and he's been in Washington, D.C. for a while. And he said, everything I've known in my part of Washington, D.C., in terms of religious groups, is for the most part collapsing. I mean, I live in Western Massachusetts. I mean, we see an awful lot of empty churches. No longer clergy are not available to fill some of those. We see empty Catholic churches. There's something going on. Now, that may have a different interpretation. But I think what Casanova may have been saying is that the structural prominence of well-known religions is no longer as dominant as it once was. And he talks about this new denominationalism, which is taking root, involving the pluralistic nature of the world. So he says, what we see in America is a much greater pluralism. I mean, Buddhism and Hinduism and a number of other religions would never have been taught at some of the major universities 10 or 15 years ago. They're now being taught. There's a shift going on. Now, you might be right. They're imprecise in how they explain that. But others may wish to react to this or other comments that you may have. Thank you for that contribution.
I absolutely agree with what Tamara said, and I think there is a fundamental imperative for every school from elementary schools or high school that religions get taught, all religions, mm-hmm. all religions. Because myself, I'm an Italian Christian, I'm in master's, so it is now for a whole year, and it just opened my mind. And once, and since religion is still very present, and our family is becoming even more present than what it was mm-hmm. when we were younger, it is fundamental for everyone to have a study or at least an outlook for religions, because mm-hmm. it's so easy within religions to fall within the cluster of the parameters that they set. And that's when, I think religion is probably the most powerful tool for violence.
It's a very interesting point that you make. And as an American with a partial view, I clearly don't have a view of every college and university in America, but some of the larger schools in America are moving to eliminate religion departments. And the reason for that is they believe that religion is responsible for so many of the negatives, and we need to have more. The big term is diversity, okay? So, I mean, for example, in the college I teach in, the big theme right now is the theme of diversity. And many people understand that as the elimination of religion departments. So I forget now how many in the religion department I once served in, but I would say that is down to half. And certain people are not, certain areas are not being renewed. So we've just lost a key figure in Buddhism. He is not renewed. We've lost the major figure in Christianity. That person is not being renewed. And so that is the other phenomena. How you understand the definition of diversity. Because very often diversity rules out the very thing that it thinks it's trying to defend. So I would say what we have in large sections of America today is a basic confusion. And the question is, how do we get that confusion?
But it's not only in America, because we have done the same thing in Italy.
Right.
They used to have crucifix in the elementary schools,
right.
Public elementary schools. To accommodate diversity, to accommodate new students from other religions, they decided to remove the crucifix yep. from the room. By doing that, they decided to cancel as well also the religious classes,
yep.
which was insane.
Yep.
Which is insane, because yep. they're trying to accommodate diversity by
right.
about the diverse right. cluster, which is a different
yeah.
religious
right. group. But the problem would be, as soon as you try to talk out publicly about that, you would be labeled as somebody who was anti-diversity.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes. Yes, please.
But the point is, I was trying
Yes.
But it's because the word religion is being abused by people in power. So it's used in a positive way when it suits them, and it's used in a negative way when they want to allude the masses to a particular thing. For example, Islam recently has been spoken about as a really negative religion which breeds hate and which breeds negativity and in which females have absolutely no right. It's just blatant lies. In Australia, where I grew up, the one and only mass shooting we had was committed by a white Christian male. But that's not spoken about at all. It's all about Islam. And I absolutely, what really upsets me is when people say that religion doesn't play a role in politics. Well, whether or not we like to admit it, it actually does. Because all of the world wars that we've had have been based on religion, and not real religion, but man's interpretation of religion. And that's the issue. That's the core fundamental issue here. It's that human beings, and I guess this is, and I'm a religious person, this is the thing that God has given us, is free will. And unfortunately, some people are misusing that free will and are interpreting books, religious books, in their own way, and are running with that, and are continuing to spread and breed hate, which is an issue.
I just want to raise a question we can talk about as we progress. How does one effectively counter some of those tendencies? I mean, I think some of you have spoken very forcefully. How does one counter some of those tendencies? I mean, just to take your last point, I think that in many ways is a good solution in Egypt. You teach about religion or a religious tradition within that tradition. But you know what would be the immediate outcry in my part of America would be, you're catering to that religious tradition. You're teaching internally what we should be dealing with critically, but they won't deal with it critically, you see? What do you think in the first place is causing the refugee problem? Or those people? I mean, the other side of that refugee, that whole business that's being hidden, is that last year, some figures I got from the UN, 160,000 Christians were killed. That's the other side of it, you see. So the question is...
But that's 150,000 because in these countries, in these Middle Eastern countries, there are Christians living with Muslims. So if you bomb Egypt, for example, you're going to bomb 500,000 Muslims. You would still bomb 10,000 Christians. Mm-hmm. They're still Egyptian as well.
Yeah.
So the U.S. bombing or whatever X country bombing Y country, there would be minorities within these majority that attribute to the majority of the initial bombing country.
Mm-hmm.
I think also that's a very valid point, but there's also the other point that there are Christians fleeing persecution from radicalized, and I'm not going to call them Muslim, I'm just going to call them radicalized individuals. The amount of Christian refugees that I met last year when I was volunteering in Belgrade was horrifying, absolutely horrifying. These people are being forced from their lands. Along with their Muslim neighbors, they're both fleeing a make-believe religion. Like, it's terrifying. So there are two sides of the story, but I think that if we want to look at the refugee crisis as a whole, it's time for people to stop putting their hands in their pockets and turning their heads around and actually own up to the mistakes that we have all made in the West. Because we have. It's a contribution from a number of countries in the West who continuously see themselves as the world police and feel that they need to meddle in people's business when they really don't. We have a look at who was arming, Al-Qaeda, who was arming Bin Laden, who was arming ISIS. I mean, it's really easy to track where the ammunition and where the guns are coming from and where the training is coming from. We can't say, oh, no, it's a refugee problem, shut the door, and then continue to give these people guns and other such things. I mean, this conversation is going to go around and around until somebody who is truly brave steps in and says enough is enough. But at the end of the day, peace doesn't make enough money as war does, so...
Well, you know, you raise an interesting question that's been going through my mind, and that is whether at this juncture in world history, we may perhaps need, whatever you want to call it, some mechanism where the truth can be spoken, right? And I'm not convinced that's necessarily the United Nations. I'm convinced it's not. That's not to say the United Nations has not done a lot of good work. But how could one, and I'm think we have to solve that now, but as you go through the semester here and you dialogue with each of you who have rich insights as well as other people, instructors, what mechanisms in the world for truth telling could be helpful? And how would that come about? Because all I can say right now in the United States, everything is converted immediately into political talk. He or she is for this person or that person. And you cannot speak, in a sense, the truth. And I think maybe the time really has come for honest talk, which does not have repercussions. Because some of us think we may be speaking the truth or we're not. But we need to be told that. But I mean, there needs to be that kind of an opportunity. And for example, I went, my undergraduate work was at Columbia College, and there was a degree, we were taught how to speak the truth. Now, I don't know whether, how well that works today, but for example, it's easy to pick on somebody and say that person's all messed up. We had certain courses that we had to take, and there were maybe 12 or 13 in the humanities course, and there was a situation where, let's say a philosopher, who I could not stand, but somebody else thought was very helpful. Well, what we had to do is we had to go around, the 12 of us had to take a figure, number one, that we were told to report on, and to learn how to report about that person truthfully, and the same thing on the other side. And that, I must say, has always helped me to look at both sides, or at the attempt to look at both sides of an issue in a rather critical way. So I'm just raising the question whether, as we come to this world, we're not too intrigued with hard power, I'm certainly not. Cultural diplomacy is making its way, but it's making its way in a world that's radically and rapidly changing, is there perhaps an international group that doesn't seek to make peace but just wishes to talk about some of the issues? Yes.
I think the real question here is, are we prepared to hear the truth?
That's the other thing.
And we have been privy to such information with Julian Assange, who has been hiding out in the Ecuadorian embassy, while in London, for speaking the truth. And of course then Australia is going to say, well, he was, you know, talking about things which were affecting our national security and whatnot, and I understand that. However, who decides how much of the truth we should be privy to, and who decides how much of the truth we shouldn't be privy to? And that's kind of the problem, I guess, in the world today.
Also, the kind of the papers, so the truth is out there. Is anyone going to do anything about it?
Sure. Well, that's why I think it's so, I mean, a lot of these deals have to deal with money. Why it's so important to take seriously the increasing criticism that globalization is just another way for those who have capital to make more capital, easier to sell their goods. Is that what we want with globalization? And the other, I mean, we've covered a lot of important stuff that you want to talk or think about. Talk to yourselves, one another, about any other sharings of thoughts. Well, maybe we've reached the limit. I think you should spend the next half hour or so, 20 minutes, whatever you have, wherever you want, just maybe talking with one another, thinking about this whole phenomena that we have been discussing this morning. I find the conversation has been enriching for me. Not that it immediately has given me answers how we move forward, but somehow we need to move forward because I, for one, am not intrigued with hard power being the ruling game in the future. But maybe the other alternative is to say, to hell with it, give up, and let's see what happens. I'm not, well, personally, willing to take that road either. But if we really believe that we need to talk about these matters in realistic, honest, rational ways, how do we do that? Should there be something new afoot? What is the role that cultural diplomacy could play in that situation? Now, it's amazing when you go down and look around the buildings, this building here, the ICD building, you see all the pictures of world leaders. You wonder, with that capital of people, whether something can get started. Well, I thank you for your time, and I thank you for having learned from you. Good. Enjoy your time in Berlin.